to the Coleraine Presbyterian Church. In these days when the dark clouds of fear overshadow us, we are uplifted and encouraged by faith. In the risen sun, this morning, may we enter the light of his presence. Please join me in the call to worship. Then I looked and heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands and 10,000 times 10,000. They encircled the throne and the living creatures and elders.
In a loud voice, they were saying, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise."
Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on the sea and all that is in them saying, "To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever."
The four living creatures said, "Amen," and the elders fell down and worshiped.
Not only that, we reach down into the pit of sin and death and
and by the resurrection power of your Son, you raised us up to new life.
Because you first loved us, we turn to you.
Humble our hearts and worship you. Amen. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to our online services. Again, I believe this is about the fourth week that we have worshiped online together. But even if you are gathered in your homes and we are here, we are gathering together, unified by the Spirit of God, for where two or three have gathered in Christ's name, God's Spirit is in our midst. One announcement I want to make this morning is our regularly scheduled session meeting, which would be this coming Monday. We are going to postpone that until we hear from the governor exactly what our guidelines should be for the month of May. And once we know those guidelines and we understand more clearly how the world around us is going to open up again, whether it be slowly, whatever steps we need to take as far as those guidelines go, as soon as we understand those guidelines, we will call a session meeting then, and we will discuss how we are going to reopen the church to gather here again and worship. I checked with my two partners as we present this service week by week, and neither one of them had any announcements, so we will move on to the children's sermon. Boys and girls, this morning I would like to talk about being afraid, and I know that we are living in times that cause us to be afraid, and I'm sure all of you have heard about this terrible disease, this virus that is going around, and I'm sure you worry about your families, you worry about your brothers and sisters and moms and dads. You don't want anybody to catch this virus, and you probably think about your grandparents, your grandma and grandpa, and because they're older, they are especially do not want to catch this virus. And so I put a picture of my family up there, and we pray every day for each and every person in our family that God would watch over us and protect us. And it's important that we are concerned at this time of our lives because of what's happening around us. But God doesn't want us to be overcome with fear. God doesn't want us to be too afraid, because that is not good for our minds or our bodies. So we need to be concerned, but not to be too afraid. And there's a good Bible story that talks about this very thing. One day Jesus was up on top of the mountain teaching the crowds. He was teaching them about God's kingdom and all that God wanted them to do to be people who would bring forth God's love into the world. He was teaching them all these important lessons. And when he finished, he told his disciples that they were to go down and get in a boat and cross the lake to the other side, but he needed time to go up on the mountain and pray. That was very important to Jesus. Whenever he would go up on the mountain and pray, oh man, God would give him strength on the inside. And prayer does that for us. It makes us strong on the inside. Well, the disciples got in the boat. When they were out on the boat, a big storm hit. The waves were really big and they were being tossed back and forth, and they became very afraid because they thought they were going to die out there on the sea in this big storm. Suddenly they looked out onto the sea and they saw this being, this person out there glowing, and he looked like a ghost. And that made them even more afraid. What were they going to do now? A ghost was walking their way. But suddenly they heard these words, "Do not be afraid, it is I." And they recognized that it was Jesus coming to them walking on the water. And one of the disciples, Peter, said, Lord, if it is you, tell me to come to you on the water, and I will come. And Jesus said, come to me, Peter, come. And Peter stepped out of the boat. And as long as he was focused on Jesus, he stayed above the water and walked across the water. But when the waves started to rage and get bigger, the wind started to blow, he became afraid and he took his eyes off Jesus and he looked at the waves and he looked at the wind and the storm and he began to sink. But fortunately, Jesus was right there, reached down and grabbed him and helped him back into the boat. There's a very important lesson we need to learn from that story. During scary times, like the times we're going through now, it's important for us to keep our eyes focused on Jesus. When we do that, we learn to trust God instead of being frightened by the scary things that are happening around us. And as we learn to trust God through these kinds of times, God leads us step by step by step through these difficult days. Now, why is that important? Well, it's important because with every step, the Lord leads us out of the storm to a safe place. So during the storm, keep your eyes focused on the Lord and taking one step at a time. And do not fear, but trust in God, and He will get you and your family through. Amen.
Knowing that we are flawed human beings living in a fallen world, we come humbly before our holy God. And it is by God's grace through His Son that we can be restored and renewed. Please join me in the prayer of confession. All praise and glory to you, O God, who loved us enough to give us life on this earth and extend to us eternal life through the Son, Jesus Christ. Help us to understand this wonderful love. May we grow in our love for you and for people. We know sin blocks your love in our lives. In weakness, we turn away from your love and choose substitutes that never satisfy. Forgive us, O Lord, for all things we have done that offend you. Grant us your grace and cleansing as we confess our sins in these moments of silence. Please take this time for your own personal prayer of confession. Amen.
Since God has forgiven us in Christ, let us forgive one another. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. This time, let us come before the Lord and seek the Lord in prayer. If you have any prayer requests that we need to update, please email them to me. And my email address is joecellis@comcast.net, and I will update the prayer request. Or you could just give me a call. Let us come before the Lord and seek Him in prayer. Lord, we do thank You for this day, this opportunity to worship You, and I pray for each and every person out there and each and every family out there. Continue to watch over us, continue to protect us. We pray, Lord, that day by day and step by step, You would lead us out of this darkness, this time of danger, this time of threat that we are in. Lord, help us to keep our eyes focused upon You through these through this valley. And as we do, You will lead us to a better place, to a safer place, and we will trust You every step of the way. We lift up our nation to You, and we pray for our leaders that You would guide them, help them to understand the best decisions to make. We lift up the world to You as this virus goes around the world, making people sick and causing death. We pray, Lord, that the world leaders would understand what to do. Lord, we pray that through it all, in this battle, that we would unite in faith and grow closer to You and stronger spiritually. Lord, we know that this world is a temporary world. We know that one day all of us will come to the end of each of our lives. We pray, Lord, that when that time comes, we will be spiritually ready. And we pray that we would speak that message into this world during these kinds of times, how important it is for people to become spiritually ready to make it through this life and to face the life after this one, that eternal life that You have offered to each and every person. Lord, we thank You for the opportunity to lift these prayers up to You. We've been praying for these people for a while, and we ask that Your power be upon their lives. Continue to be with all these people battling cancer. We lift up Karen to You and Denny. We think of Tammy and Sally, Kathy Gonon, Stephanie Duck. Watch over each and every one of them, Lord. Some of these people are going through treatments. Some of them have been through treatments. Lord, whether they be going through or have completed their treatments, watch over them and heal them. Continue to be with Anna and Gail. Watch over Jean and Ed and Sharon. Be with them, Lord. Touch them and heal them. We think of Ron and John Mann and Tia and Tom Bruni. We continue to pray for them. Jennifer's mom, Pat, Lad Riser, Jackie's dad, Jack, we lift up to You, Lord, and ask that Your hand of healing be upon each of them. We think of Marlene and Donna. We think of young Leo and ask that he would continue to be cancer-free. Be with young Dominic. Be with Karen. We lift all these people up to You in this battle against cancer, and we pray for victory. Lord, we continue to pray for those looking for Brian and Joni. We ask, Lord, that You would help them, lead them, give them clues. We lift up young Sophia and be with her and her family in their battle against the diabetes. Watch over this young gal. Continue to be with Kay, battling Parkinson's. Ron Foster with COPD and health problems, be with him and his wife Linda, watch over them. Be with Colton, battling diabetes. We think of Lisa, continue to heal her knee. Continue to be with Juanita and her hip. Watch over Donna and the difficulty she's going through, and Libby's mom Greta, be with her. We lift up Peggy to You and pray that her vision would continue to improve. Watch over Nancy. Be with her, we pray. We think of young Luca and ask that he would grow strong enough for this heart surgery that he so definitely needs. Be with him. Oh, we lift up these unspoken requests by several people. We lift them up to you. You know what they are. You will guide and direct. Be with these unspoken requests. We pray that whatever needs to fall into place will fall into place. Continue to be with Dave Bruni, recovering from heart surgery. Vic Sterling, recovering from paralysis. Be with Carly Fairbanks and her health, Lord. Watch over her. We thank you, Shirley Benline, and continue to pray for her. Be with her. Randy Walker and his health, we lift up to you. Lord, we lift up Sue and Bill together, battling Bill's Parkinson's problem. Be with Julie Tingler's stepmom, Connie, who was diagnosed with the coronavirus. She has COPD, so be with her, Lord, and help her through this battle. We pray for her healing. Watch over her. So, Lord, we thank you for all these people, and we ask your blessing upon all of them. We pray for this church, that you would bless this church and its ministry as we finish off the month of May and enter into, as we finish off the month of April and enter into May, we pray that your light would shine and that we would be able to gather back here again soon and worship together without fear. We pray for all those things that need to fall into place. Lord, we want to see this ministry continue to make a difference in this community. We want to see the young people's ministry grow. And we'd like to see that Bible school happen this summer. So we put all these things into your hands, and we are trusting that you will bless this church and move us forward in this ministry. We pray, Lord, that this epidemic would end soon. So, Lord, we thank you for all these things, and now we pray together the prayer that your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This time we're going to put up the church address so you can send in your gifts, your offerings, and your tithes, and we'll leave it up there while Ryan plays the offertory. Kingdom in this world. We know that when your kingdom moves forward in this world, lives are touched, people are healed, people are saved. We thank you for this opportunity, Lord, to give to that work. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our Old Testament reading this morning comes from the book of Psalms, chapter 16. Keep me safe, my God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. Apart from you, I have no good thing. I say of the holy people who are in the land, they are the noble ones, in whom is my delight. Those who run after other gods will suffer more and more. I will not pour out my libations of blood to such gods or take up their names on my lips. Lord, you alone are my portion and my cup. You make my lot secure. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Surely I have a delightful inheritance. I will praise the Lord who counsels me. Even at night, my heart instructs me. I keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body also will rest secure, because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead, nor will you let your faithful one see decay. You make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. This ends the reading of our Old Testament.
As we come to our time of praise, I like this song here, and I chose it with just finishing up Easter and Good Friday and all that transpired in that time of the church. God, what God did for us dying on the cross, what awesome love that he had for us to do that. And we can fall down and bring our sins and our wrongs to him so that he can take them and wash them away for us. So let's go ahead and sing this song together.
Mercy and love at the feet.
Until that day, we receive your inheritance, that inheritance that can never spoil, that inheritance that is kept with you in your eternal kingdom. One day we will see that, and that is our living hope. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Have you ever noticed that the news media is very good at maintaining a high level of fear in the hearts of its audience? I don't care if you are a die-hard CNN fan or Fox News fan, or if you watch CBS or NBC or ABC, all of them prescribe to the same philosophy. Fear sells. If you watch a nightly broadcast for half an hour, I guarantee you that you will be able to write down at least 15 things that stir fear in the hearts of people. I mean, for now, the COVID-19 virus, it is the big one. But if you sit there and listen, you'll hear all kinds of other ones, possible terrorist attacks, increases in certain kinds of cancer, gang activity, the opiate epidemic, and then there's always the threats from China and Russia and North Korea and Iran. And then the left will say, we better be afraid of the president's bad decisions. They're going to come back to haunt us. And the right will say, we better be afraid of the democratic socialist agenda of the Democrats. And what will happen there? And then you hear about global warming and recession, scam phone calls and identity theft, and the list goes on and on. News outlets have discovered that the presentation of the news in a manner that raises the highest level of fear creates the best ratings. The almighty dollar conditions the news producers to exaggerate and spin and speculate and even lie if it's going to get that fear level up another notch. So it's become a battle. News networks are trying to outfear each other. Now, why is that? Well, it's because fear is a form of control. If they can control you, then they can make more money off of you. How do they do that? Through advertising dollars. The higher their ratings, the more companies pay them for advertising. Now, I might sound like a conspiracy theorist, but I tell you what, I watch all those channels. I watch CNN, I watch Fox, I watch ABC, NBC, CBS, I watch them all so that I can get a broader view of what's being said, and somehow I can sift out the truth from hearing from different sides. And to me, and it is obvious, they believe that fear sells. Now, I'm not saying we don't need to be careful. We do need to be careful. I'm not saying we don't need to follow the government's guidelines. We do need to follow those guidelines. We need to be safe in these days of crisis. I am not saying that we need to rebel or anything like that. But what I am saying is fear can be a way that someone else can gain control over us and use fear to shape our decisions and use fear to gain financially through increased advertising. We need to be aware of that. Here's the bigger problem, though. Being controlled by fear can do psychological damage to a person and physical damage to a person. Prolonged fear can incapacitate us. It weakens our immune system. It causes cardiovascular disease. It causes stomach ulcers. It causes us to lose memory function, accelerated aging, even infertility. It can increase our anxiety and our paranoia. It can interrupt the processes that our brains need to regulate our emotions. And all of these things impact our decision making and make us more impulsive and reactive in our decision making. Long-term fear causes incredible damage to a person. Now, the countermeasure to the damage caused by fear is faith. Fear may sell, but faith saves. You see, faith redirects our focus from something that is detrimental to the one who is empowering. Listen to the psalmist's words from Psalm 16 again. Keep me safe, my God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. Apart from you, I have no good thing. See, like us, the psalmist had many things that he could fear. In fact, in his day, there were even scarier things than we are facing now. When a plague came upon an earth back then, there was no medicines and no hospitals. The mortality rate was much higher. His nation, Israel, was under constant threat from various powerful empires that wanted control over Israel, and so violence and bloodshed was a constant threat. However, the psalmist knew how important it was to have the right focus. His safe place was in his relationship with God. When he focused on his fears, when he focused on the worldly dangers, the threats, the disease, the wars, his heart filled with anxiety, and his hope diminished and sank. He drifted in the quagmire of downheartedness and depression. But when he focused on God, his relationship with God deepened. And the Lord poured into him strength and light and life. And God lifted him up above the darkness of fear. The psalmist went on to say this: I will praise the Lord who counsels me. Even at night my heart instructs me. I keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him at my right hand, I will not be shaken. See, with his focus on God, the psalmist received instruction and wisdom and understanding. He said, even at night, when I'm lying there in bed, I focus on the God and God teaches me. This is the kind of relationship that God wants with us. It is a relationship of revelation, of eternal truth and powerful life principles that God unveils to us to help us manage our lives step by step and day by day in these unstable, threatening circumstances in which we live. That is why it is so important not to allow yourself to be controlled by fear, but rather to refocus on God so that you can be illuminated and taught and empowered to live effectively and even abundantly in the kind of world that we're living in. Now let's focus on a passage of Scripture where God is teaching these powerful truths and principles. Let's listen to see what Peter has to say. 1 Peter 1, 3-5. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and to an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. Peter says, look what just happened. The resurrection. Open your eyes and understand what this means. Darkness and disease and destruction and death, although it may surround us, it cannot win. When God raised Jesus from the dead, all of those things were defeated. You see, through the resurrection, God created a means by which we can be born anew with a living hope. Now, what does that mean? We were born once physically, but the resurrection has made possible a spiritual birth. Christ, raised from the dead and then ascended, has made possible the downloading of that seed of Christ to be planted within us. How? By faith. This planting of this seed of Christ's Spirit gives us new life and a living hope. Now, why is it a living hope? Peter says that it can never perish, it can never spoil, it can never fade, because that living hope is not physical, it is spiritual. Well, how is this living hope, this eternal spiritual seed planted within us? How is it conceived? By faith it is conceived. It is a spiritual conception by faith. You see, this is how it happens when you believe and when you receive the Spirit of God, then you conceive. A part of God Almighty unites within you and begins to grow within you. This union with you and God creates an eternal part within you. It creates a union that puts you right into God's family. And that eternal part of you that God unites with you inside of you, that welcomes you into God's kingdom. But here's the thing. We still must live out our lives on this earth until the day we cross over into that spiritual eternal kingdom. Eternal life in the presence of God is our inheritance. But that hope begins now. That is why it is a living hope, just as Peter said. You know what the opposite of fear is? Well, the opposite of fear is faith. And all the things that composes faith, an inner assurance, an inner boldness, a confidence in God, a hope in that eternal life, a courage to move forward and do God's will, a fortitude within, all of those things, all of those qualities, God gives us through faith. God empowers us through faith to move through these dark days, until we come to that day where we receive our inheritance. Fear sells. Are you buying? Faith saves. Are you trusting? Amen. Let's sing our final hymn. In my heart there rings a melody. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
Father.